They're watching you get dressed at the minute.
My name is Father Roger Butcher. Welcome to those watching online live. Welcome to those who will be watching later. Welcome to our congregation as well. We're a bit smaller in number today, but you know, a tangerine is not a failed orange. Tangerines are very small, sweet and juicy. So we're small, sweet and juicy today, aren't we? Just before I start, just a couple of notices. The first notice to say that all the churches in the Benefice have been installed with QR codes. It's a modern mosaic of black and white image, which is attached to the doors as well as you come in. And if you have the NHS app installed on your phone, you can now enter church, zap the QR code, and it will register that you've been in this place. It's a good idea. Alternatively, if you're not au fait with modern technology, you can just use the good old-fashioned pen and paper to sign in. Generally speaking about the COVID situation at the moment, whilst there is a great anxiety and stress that we are in a second wave, in saying that, the science, the evidence at the moment supports that whilst more people are catching COVID, the death rate seems to be falling. And we don't know the reasons why. In that is an articulation of hope. So whilst things look difficult and are difficult, there is this hope that the death rate is remaining quite low at the moment, but we don't know why. There is a hope in that. Let's hang on to that. Let's start our service by singing our first hymn. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven.
Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. come together to sing, to give our souls and our hearts and our minds a good spring cleaning. Wasn't that wonderful? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God, grace, mercy and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Our Lord is alive, let us prepare the fertile soil of our hearts and minds to receive him. As together we say,
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sin, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So together, let us confess our sin in penitence and in faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commands and to live in love and peace with all.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that it was, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Would you please accept God's forgiveness? Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sin, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in everlasting life. Through your Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
repeating this proverb concerning the land of Israel. The fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As I live, declares the Lord God, this proverb shall no more be used by you in Israel. Behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the father as well as the soul of the son is mine. The soul who sins shall die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. Hear now, O house of Israel, is my way not just? Is it not your ways that are not just? When a righteous person turns away from his righteousness and does injustice, he shall die for it. For the injustice that he has done, he shall die. Again, when a wicked person turns away from the wickedness he has committed and does what is just and right, he shall save his life, because he considered and turned away from all the transgressions that he had committed. He shall surely live, he shall not die. Yet the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord is not just. O house of Israel, are my ways not just? Is it not your ways that are not just? Therefore I will judge you, O house of Israel, everyone according to his ways, declares the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions. Let iniquity be your ruin. Cast away from all the transgressions that you have committed, and make yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, O house of Israel? For I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the Lord God. So turn and live. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.
Jesus entered the temple. The chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, by what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? Jesus said to them, I will ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? And they argued with one another. If we say from heaven, he will say to us, why then did you not believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And he said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work in the vineyard today. He answered, I will not. But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same. And he answered, I go, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said the first. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And so now I speak in the name of one God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please do be seated. My lovely lady, always supporting, wonderful which she is, has been keeping chickens for the last
3 years,
four years, and she rehomes them, and we've had about three rehoming groups of chickens, and I've learnt a lot from it. studying chickens. They're an interesting little animal, aren't they? And when you put chickens together in one cage, then the chickens will group and they will then start to peck each other. And the chicken with the most peck, the greatest ferocity, the chicken which can draw blood, tends to go up in the order of chickens. And those which are on the receiving end of that forceful peck, of that bleeding from their skin, those chickens become subservient. So they tend to fall away, if you like, in the group order. And our chief chicken is called Michael. He's been given a male name, interestingly. The chicken, I was thinking about this today, I thought, I hope we've got no one in our congregation called Michael. You'll see why it won't go with this. But this Michael chicken has now got a little big red plumage crown and is looking more and more larger as well. In chickens, there is a hierarchy. There are those which are subservient to the others, and they become subservient because their flesh is broken by the beak of the chicken, which is more important, and they start to bleed. And so each time you add chickens into the group, they sort themselves out. This is an established principle in science called the pecking order. You've probably heard of it. It's the same with monkeys as well. In a group of monkeys, there becomes an appointed monkey who is the leader. There's a pecking order in monkeys, just as there is in many animal kingdoms. There is an established pecking order. And so it is with us human beings. There is an established pecking order in our groups. But our Lord said this. He said, the last is first, and to serve one another. And our Lord girded himself with a towel, and he said, you call me Lord and Master. So if you wash your feet, you wash the feet of others. And Jesus brought about this authority of service, that we are to serve, particularly those who are the furthest away from God. We heard today of the prostitutes and the tax collectors, those which are deemed the furthest away from God. And the chief priests were told that you are supposed to serve. And so the Christian has a service. We are there to serve others. We are in our authority. We serve. But Jesus does something else. He goes beyond this. Because he says love is attached to service. Love is attached to service. Remember that incident with Peter where he says, do you love me? And Peter answers back with a family type of love. Yeah, of course I love you, he says. And Jesus says, no, 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 do you really love me? And then in the Greek he answers back with a higher love, a more agapeic love, a selfless love. He says, yes, my Lord, I do love you. Christians are called to service and love. And on that cross we see that ultimate symbol of love and service in the authority of God. There our Lord is nailed to that cross, and he hangs from that cross as a loving service to all that follow him. So here is our point. Here's our very first point. Our Lord uses his body as an instrument of authority. His divine powers, his truths, come through his body towards us. Just as a pencil is the container for lead. A lead that communicates word, which communicates meaning. Our Lord uses his body as a container to communicate his authority, his service, and his love towards this world. That's our first point.
And our second point, we hear today of these chief priests who ask a question of Jesus, and it's a dishonest question. They don't want to know the answer. We all do this. We ask questions of people. We often don't want to know the answer. But our Lord flushes out this motive. He says, is John's baptism from heaven or from earth? And the people believe that John is a godly man. They believe that he's from heaven, a prophet, if you like. So if they say from earth, the crowd will disown the chief priests. And if they say that it's from earth, then they undermine the authority. And so they reply, we don't really know. Rowan Williams was recently asked the question of what question should we as individuals ask ourselves? Rowan Williams said, who do I tell the truth to? Who do I tell my truth to? When we ask this honest question, what we're really doing is we're articulating a hope not to hear the answer, that does not fit in with my attitudes and motives. And so Williams is picking up on this thought. Who do I trust with my truth? Who do you trust with your truth? And the church is here, it's an established body which is here to listen without judging. It's to probe us individually and gently, to help us discover our fears and our hopes. In the presence of God, it makes no sense not to tell truth. And if people can articulate, this principle is evident in all our lives. Even a non-believer can get together with someone else, with friends, and discuss what their truths are. But at some point, you need someone to say you need to speak it. There is a priority within us that needs to be found, that we do need to speak our own truths, however distorted they are. And our last, even the most perceptive people can fool themselves. C.S. Lewis notes that we become so absorbed with our own moral improvement. We want to be that moral good person in the sense that God wants us to be. God wants us to be a certain person, we say. We want to be that good. But Lewis mentions that mere morality is not the end of life. We're made as humans for something else. On that top of that mountain, God asks to us, he says, when we climb up, he says, do you want to be remade? Do you want to go back down that mountain? Do you want to go back down that mountain? If you do, follow me. And as we walk down that mountain, we go back into the vineyard, which our Lord uses, this analogy, a vineyard where there's an abundance of work, but not many workers. On that top of the mountain, of that moral mountain, which we think the good that God wants us to be, on that mountain, we often fall short of getting to the top. But there we meet our Lord, who says, do you want to be remade? If so, I'll send you out into loving service, into my vineyard. And there, and it's there, the pickings, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. Together, let's us declare our faith in one common. Together, we say, we believe
in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father. Begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
So let us pray to our Heavenly Father.
God has called us. As we gather in his name, let us bring him our prayers, which come from our love and concern for one another. Lord, we thank you for all the help and encouragement we are given from your church, from its worship, teaching, fellowship, from its faithfulness in prayer. Bless and further all loving ministry in word and sacrament throughout the world, throughout the church. Inspire us all to want to do your will and to follow that will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the world, where there is misery and tragedy of the wrong choices, grief that grieves your heart of love. Let there be wisdom and compassion in all negotiations and decisions. Let there be humility in leadership, and that those leaders lead responsibly, with courage and wisdom, for right action to be shared by all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we bring to you the joys and the worries, the frustrations and the accomplishments of this week, in the lives that we have met, the experiences that we have shared. As we pray, let your light shine into all these lives for fresh direction and a lasting good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we bring to you those we know who are ill or suffering in mind, body or spirit, for those who are in hospital, for those who are recovering or receiving treatment, for illnesses seen and unseen, for those who are anxious and concerned of the weeks and months ahead, for those who are grieving. Give them healing, restore them in body, mind and spirit, and provide them with your indwelling, Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we remember in your presence all those who have died, and particularly those who have known and loved you. We bring to you today Colin Davis from Piddle Trentide, Miriam House, formerly from Hilton. Thank you for them, and thank you for your promise of eternal life and peace. May we comfort one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for your offer of life in all its abundance. May we accept it with joy every day of our lives. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. So if you're able to, would you please stand as we share in the peace. The peace we share in is not a worldly peace, but it is a godly peace. It is peace with God, where our hearts and our minds and our souls are at rest. There we find true peace with God, and we find true peace with each other. Christians share in that peace. Jesus Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God by his one body upon the cross. We meet in his name and we share in his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So let us offer symbolically one another a sign of God's peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. For he is your living word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of a woman and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a people for your own possession. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name forever, praising you and singing.
Oh,
betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He gave it to you. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as you drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ your Son, our Lord. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise.
Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen.
And so, believing in the promises of God, let us pray as our Saviour has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Twice, and I will come down and communicate you from the
reserve sacrament. This was consecrated on Thursday. I believe that we can continue with that process. But before we do that, the Anglican way has always been to affirm the bread, the nourishment and the wine as life rafts of salvation. They are helpful to us as we proceed through life. Let us affirm them as those life rafts. The body of Christ.
Amen. Amen.
The blood of Christ.
Amen.
Amen. So together let us pray. Almighty God, you have taught us through your Son that love is the fulfilling of the law. Grant that we may love you with our whole heart and our neighbours as ourselves. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Together we say the prayer after communion.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Amen. And so, before you go out into the world to accept God's blessing, but please do go pondering that authority of Jesus. Much of our relationships are like chickens. We go around pecking each other. We exercise our power over each other. We want our opinions to come out of the mouths of others. Church can be like chickens sometimes. PCC meetings can be like chickens. Works at all levels, doesn't it? Much of our lives can be like chickens. Jesus takes the authority of himself, connects it with servitude, and connects it with love. And it's from that mountain, as we climb up that mountain, even as a chicken, and I think Lewis is right when he says we Christians, we think about what God wants us to be morally good. We climb up that mountain, on that facet of that mountain, there's chickens with us. And there's Christians who try to be morally good. And God says to us, do you want to be remade? Do you want to be sent out into the world, remade? Then repent. he sent us out in loving service. There is no other model of authority like it. It's unique to us. So let us serve each other and serve our neighbour. In doing so, no one can call you a chicken. Would you please accept God's blessing? The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you, and remain with you always. Amen. Here it is. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you for joining us at our communion service here at St Martin's Cheselbourne. God bless.